I'd like to request Professor Mustaq Ahmed I. Patel, sir, Registrar, Central University of Karnataka, to start presenting his topic, that is COVID-19 crisis effects on education sector on campus and virtual learning. Sir, the webinar now.
Good afternoon, everybody. Am I audible?
Yes,
sir, you are audible.
Yes.
I am thankful to East Calcutta Girls College and West Bengal State University for giving me an opportunity to be with all of you. My fellow friends, Professor Abhijit Kumar Pal, Professor Devashri Banerjee, Dr. Soma Nandi, Dr. Zakir Hussain, Dr. Ajit Mandal, my fellow presenter, Dr. Shanali Chakrabarti Acharya, Dr. Arindam Bose, and all other participants. I am thankful and looking forward for my presentation today. Kindly allow me to start with my presentation. Is it visible to all of you?
Yes.
I am going to talk about COVID-19 crisis effects on education sector. I am going to look into on-campus and virtual learning. I have divided my presentation into various categories which I have indicated here. This presentation will be basically based on school education and higher education. Both I am going to cover. I am going to talk about face-to-face as well as virtual education, and I am going to look into various aspects of government and private institutes. To begin with, what is COVID? By now all of us are aware, what is COVID? It is an infectious disease. It was discovered as a newly coronavirus in December 2019. And it has affected, the affected person experiences mild to moderate symptoms and recover without special treatment. How it spreads? It spreads through, transmitted through droplets generated when an infected person coughs, sneezes or exhales. When we touch the surfaces wherein the virus is lying, it enters through our eyes and nose. Whether it has affected education sector. When we look at various sectors like economy, energy, medicine, transport, housing, all the sectors are affected, and similarly it has affected the education sector also. It has shaken routine teaching learning process, what was taking place in the classroom. It is having more impact than the earthquake. The only difference is earthquake, we come out of the house, and coronavirus has made us go inside the house, that is to contain the virus. Thus, there is abrupt closure and it is exceptional nature. We are closing all the institutions like school, colleges and universities to contain the spread of coronavirus. Other situations when we close generally is during the times of armed conflict. Unfortunately, India is facing that situation also. Due to abrupt closure, the syllabus is not completed, examinations are not conducted, foreign students are de-enrolling and going out, and teachers are losing their jobs, for example in US. And further, when we look into this, how it is affecting. Now, the positive thing when we look at this is collaborative education has come into play. Teachers, students, parents, engineers, all of us are working towards education of children. That is the best aspect of it. Does it have different impacts on education? Yes, I have categorized into short-term and long-term impacts, like decline in admission. When we talk of our university, Central University of Karnataka, previous years we had got 66,000 applicants applying to various courses in our university. Now it has declined to 43,000. That means there is decline in application, decrease in tuition fees. This is also a short-term impact which HT is going to have. But when we look at the long-term impacts, we see that job markets is declining and recession is taking place. That is how it is affecting the education. Change in preferences. Therefore, nobody would like to go in for longer duration of learning courses. And public funding, which used to happen in education, is going to take place in case of health care and business sector now. That is the long-term impact which I'm envisaging. When we look at the UNESCO data, we find that 91% of the world's student population is affected because of this present COVID crisis. And also we see that in India, 32 crore students have been affected because of this. What is the present situation? There is a positive thing that increased creativity is seen among the teachers and schools because everybody is trying to use innovative techniques. Then government in the present situation has asked us to pay salaries for March and April. I am talking about private sector. March and April also they have paid. But after that, what is going to happen in May, June salary? So there is going to be a financial crisis for teachers. What about the online material? UNICEF has developed online material which is free of cost available for educational purposes. There are two kinds of situations I am seeing. Whether internet is available or not. If internet is available, then the use of Zoom, Skype, etc. can be done. But here also I see that government of Karnataka has asked schools having standards 1 to 5 not to use online classes. If online classes are not to be used, then what has to be used? It can be a radio or television program through Swayam, Swayam Prabha or Gyanvani. This can be utilized. Educational technology market has come and responded very well. Penetration of commercial products into public education sector is taking place. And these are giving lucrative offers by giving discounts on commercialization of education. And in this situation, the teacher task force, UNESCO, and International Labour Organization has come out with certain guidelines to safeguard the teachers and educational process. They are saying that teachers should be involved in the planning. Safety of the learners is very much important in the campus. Standards of classroom and school-wide are to be maintained. Evaluation criteria has to be developed. Physical distancing has to be maintained in the class. So there are various criteria, guidelines laid down by the International Labour Organization in connection with in association with UNESCO. Now I am going to talk about what are the lessons learned. Here we have learned that human health is at risk. Whether it is student or teacher, everybody is going to have some impact on their life. Since there is impact, there is reluctance of students and teachers to return back to institutions. So we have to think this, how to change that. And there is change in job market also. Earlier, the jobs like doctor's job, IAS job were found to be very lucrative. But now, because they are more prone to COVID situations and they are interacting with COVID patients, so some people are trying to go away from this. In this situation, we also see that presently we have to address digital divide. We have to revise our curriculum and we have to empower our wider cadre of teachers. Teachers have to be empowered to deal with this situation. What is the way ahead? We are finding in India, there is lot of boom on work from home. We are talking about social distancing at workplaces like schools, colleges, which we were not talking earlier. And we have got online platforms which have emerged like Skype, Zoom, Google, Microsoft Teams, etc. However, we are finding that there is urban and rural divide. And those who are affected are having some concerns which have to be attended through counseling. Simultaneously, when we look at the extracurricular activities in our Central University of Karnataka, we are doing the activities like Ek Bharat Shrestha Bharat, the All India Association of Association of Indian Universities has asked us to do dancing, singing competition, etc., and submit the reports, videos, etc., online. And let us come back to the campus mode or face-to-face education. In face-to-face education, we are supposed to take up certain arrangements which are very much important. The first arrangements which I am speaking is about the arrangements to be made at the classroom. Classroom, what will be the sitting arrangement? What arrangements have to be made when the students come? Hand washing arrangement, etc. has to be clearly, guidelines have to be laid down. How the playground should be, what activities can be taken up for play, etc. has to be laid down. We are worried whether the COVID which falls on the surface and gets transmitted to other person. Library which is having lot many books, whether it gets transmitted. We have to prepare to look into this. Laboratory equipments are handled in science by most of the students. And when they are handling, there is likelihood of transmission of virus. How we are going to safeguard our students? Hostel is a place where students live. How the fumigation sanitization has to be done? That has to be arranged in the face-to-face mode when we are taking up. Health center facilities have to be extended, and earlier sneezing, cough, temperature, etc. were seen by the health centers. Now we have to gear up to meet the requirements of COVID. Similarly, for students, student life at the hostel, their classroom behavior, whether they can move to the city and come back, and what precautions they have to take, how they have to interact with their fellow friends, what mess etiquettes they have to do, what measures they have to take in the playground, what cultural activities they have to do. All these things, clear guidelines are to be laid. And when we look in this particular situation from the teacher's perspective, we find that the change of syllabus has to be worked out. It cannot be a bulky syllabus now, it has to be reduced. How much has to be transacted face to face, how much it can be integrated in online mode, that has to be worked out. Teaching learning process, how we are going to take up. Evaluation, how we are going to do in new situation. And of course, private institutes, how they are going to manage salaries and give. In this new situation, although we have got teacher education programs like B.Ed, B.L.Ed, etc. We have taught teaching methods, but now teaching, retraining of teachers is required for online education. And we have also to be provide equipments for teachers. At office, of course, a few office persons are asking for work from home. In such a situation, whether we are going to follow staggered pattern or shift pattern, what security measures are to be taken up, what PPE kits can be provided, is to be worked out. Next, I am going to talk about what educational arrangements are to be done. Say for example, first I am going to talk about kindergartens for health workers. Health workers are in the field to support our COVID patients. Their children, where they have to go? Kindergartens have to be opened in face-to-face mode. Hence, what measures have to be taken? Whether the class size, which used to be suppose 30 or 40 earlier, whether we are going to retain same class size or to maintain social distancing, we are going to reduce. And if there is transition to distance learning, face-to-face mode is getting converted into distance learning now, what things have to be taken up? Then increased access to technology has to be provided. We have to adapt to new technology. Then professional support and training has to be provided for teachers. For this, we have to come out with crash courses for teachers, and virtual classrooms have to be established. Chairman sir, can I proceed further? Hello. Chairman
yes,
sir, can
yes.
I proceed? Okay.
Yes,
now,
sir, you can.
Yeah, in this situation, I am seeing that there is advantage of having online and virtual education. What are the advantages? By adopting online and virtual education, we can avoid transmission of infection. Then we have to rethink on conventional mode of education, how it can be replaced. What is the alternative format which can be placed? And by providing online and virtual education, I think we can make the world-class education available for all our stakeholders. The online and virtual education is interesting, personalized, and enjoyable. And as you know, that classroom teacher takes the class for only 1 hour, but the recorded lessons can be accessed many a times. So unlimited open access is available for courses which are available under MOOCs. And the classroom teacher cannot go beyond the boundaries of the classroom, whereas the virtual teacher does not have any physical boundaries. So, moreover, the learner has got more engagement or more learning experiences. Initially, to think from the perspective of purchase the equipment, train the teachers and develop the program. But when you see the usage, the more number of usage it has got, then the cost effectiveness increases. Then students can learn from the comforts of their home. The picture and sound clarity is too much. And I'm talking about the disadvantages of programs. In present scenario, when jobs are being lost, children are forced to work, child labor has increased, then how do we expect the children to go for school education or higher education? Poor financial conditions of parents does not allow them to go for online education. And low tech or no tech facility, if the technological facility is not there, then they cannot go for higher virtual education. Face-to-face is always better because most of the times there is likelihood that we lose the connections, internet connections and continuity is broken. Therefore, further we also see that the children while listening to the class may get distracted, they may go for gaming, they may use social platforms. Thus, the engagement of students gets lost. That is why we also see that there is high dropouts for virtual education. Although it has become a global success, but its usage in Indian condition has to be studied further. Lot of research need to be done. Then digital infrastructure has to be created. Like we are still facing a problem with power supply and internet facility in India. So that has to be dealt properly, then this problem can be overcome. Then teacher training for digital use of digital system has to be done properly. Difficulty in conduct of examinations is there for the teachers. They do not know how to conduct the examination. If at all they conduct the examination, whether all objectives are achieved through virtual or online learning, that cannot be ascertained. Like a recent article of U.R. Rao said that online and virtual education is not beneficial for all the courses. Say for example, science courses cannot be taught through online and virtual mode because handling of equipments, apparatus is a skill which has to be learned in practical. Then impersonal experience, there is lack of sense of community. The teacher-taught relation, student-student relationship is missing here. So that is also a disadvantage for virtual education. Then it has got different impact on primary and higher education. There is no uniform impact on both the That is why this has also been thought. And I am going with the second last slide, the challenges of online and virtual education. When we look at the challenges of online and virtual education, we see that there is an inequality. Like PWD students, we are talking, to begin with, we are talking about normal children, how to make the education accessible to them. Then handling of socialization issues is also a challenge for all of us during the present era. Increased funding on technology. Whatever funding is being provided now, there is a lot of funding required for development of technologies. And then it comes training of teachers. Very few teachers have got strong digital skills, and many still should have the ICT skill. And when we see that handy material is being liked by the children, and they feel that it is authentic one, whereas the material available on the website cannot be taken as authentic by most of the learners. Creation of the content and dissemination is very much a challenge for teachers, and how to evaluate they have to learn. Now the solution is we should have a blended education, which how much blending has to be done, that is a challenge in present scenario. Digital safety, like most of the content is available on the website, so hackers are hacking the material and viruses attacking the material. In this situation, how digital material will be safeguarded is also a challenge which we have to look into. Developing purposeful and well-defined online program is also a big challenge in present scenario. Finally, I would call this present system of education as Education 4.0. And we are, during COVID-19 crisis, we are moving towards Education 4.0. First, 1.0 was gurukula system, wherein one master to one or few students was there. In 2.0 traditional university system, we had one teacher and many learners. The 3.0 distance learning system had one to very many learners across the system. And now when we are talking about 4.0 online education, since it has come into effect from past 10 years, but it has gained impetus after post COVID-19 situation. So presently we are in Education 4.0. With this, I thank, these are my few references. I thank the organizers, East Calcutta Girls College and West Bengal State University, and chairperson of the session for giving me an opportunity. Thank you.